I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves. Eight to they fool. Run through the night, playing with your life. Going against the pack, that's risk in your life. Better play it right. Yeah, you better play it right.
All right, folks, we are back with another edition of the Red and White Podcast. I'm your host, Evan, here with my man who's been a while, but he's back. Baseball season's back. Zach is back. Zach, how are you doing?
Doing well. Can't complain. No complaints here. Got a new little baby girl in the world, so that's the reason for awesome. The hiatus here lately. And you might hear her with a little Go Wolfpack cry in the background throughout the episode here. But yeah,
it's been a while, but it's been good. The baseball is back and taking. First of all, I felt like such a poser talking to Will about baseball. Like, after talking to you and Chance, and then Will and I talk, it's just, like, I apologize to everybody listening, like, what are these clowns talking about? Yeah, so I felt like such a poser, but, so I'm glad to have a proper baseball person back with me, so that I don't sound as stupid, and you can handle most of the conversation.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. I've, I can tell that in the last, let's see, I probably did my first one about midway through baseball season last year. I can tell your baseball enthusiasm and knowledge has grown, though, I will say. So that's good. We just got to get Will on board too, you know. Got to give him that game a chance.
And that's what's perfect about this season so far. Like, it is really, like, Omaha left a bad taste in everybody's mouth, but everybody's super mm-hmm. excited about that team, right? And then mm-hmm. we come out this year and Tommy White is just doing things that you don't expect anybody to do. And just giving us that enthusiasm, I think it was the perfect start for the baseball team to, you know, for everybody who just wanted some more after last year. I mean, it's a cool story. It's exciting. I mean, it's fun as hell to watch. And I'm in. I've been watched every game so far. You know, this mm-hmm. is the first time in a long time that I've done that. Last year, I watched some intermittently, and I relied on you and Chance for most of that stuff. But baseball is exciting, man. And I used to watch baseball growing up. I kind of fell off the wayside. Grew up a Yankees fan. Mm-hmm. But the college baseball, like, I'm in. Like, I really like it. I really enjoy it. So, yeah, I'm.
Well, I think in like other podcasts. I mean,
so, yeah, happy to be on board.
I like.
All right. We're back after some technical difficulties, but I think Zach's back. Anyway, I'm in on baseball. Like, it's exciting. It's just fun to watch. How's the season gone so far in your eyes?
Well, I think, 8-0, can't ask for much better than that. Can't ask for any better than that, really. But I think kind of hinting at what you were hinting at last year with everything that happened out in Omaha and the NCAA pulling the 2 a.m. heist and all that stuff, you know, last year in Omaha State was definitely kind of America's team. Everybody had kind of adopted pulling for State. You know, you could see it on social media and everything. And then this year with Tommy White coming out, everybody in the country who pays attention to college baseball has at least heard his name. A freshman with 9 home runs in 8 games. You know, it kind of carries over. So I think you're going to continue to see a lot of support for State's baseball team. And I mean, if you look back at last weekend, look at the crowd, you know, for Friday night against Quinnipiac when they were playing the other night, that was crazy to see that for a mid-February Friday evening game, to see that many people there and to hear, you know, I was watching it from home and to hear the enthusiasm and everything coming through from the fans, it was pretty crazy just to think about how far State has come just in the last couple years with everything, but they've definitely capitalized so far this year. Yesterday, coming from behind, down 6, I believe, and winning in the bottom of the 10th on the homer by Groover, and then, you know, just putting on another hit parade in the second game. Tommy White going yard again. You know, it's been really good. Highfield looks good. Willitson struggled a little bit coming out, but, you know, I think he's going to work that out. He's, you know, the first inning yesterday was a little rough. He got touched up a little bit, but he's around the zone for the most part. And And, you know, that's a big thing for pitchers is just throw strikes, you know, just throw strikes. This, of course, you get, you know, you're going to get hit sometimes and everything, but if you're just throwing strikes, it'll all work itself out. And, you know, you just can't be giving up free passes. And I think a couple times, you can look at the statistics, you know, if you let the first two guys get on, or like the first, if the first hitter of an inning gets on, he scores like 65 to 70% of the time or something like that. Okay. Concede that one. And then, you know, you just want to keep single keep a straight line on the scoreboard. You don't want crooked numbers up there. If you're, you know, if you're playing defense, avoid the crooked numbers. So, but State's offense has been putting up a lot of crooked numbers.
Let me ask you this one. I was sitting there watching my wife last night at the end of the game. And first of all, she's like, who's Quinnipiac? Why are they playing this school? She assumed that they are very Chesnome, small school, not legit program. But explain how baseball works and why there's so many schools with good teams and why everybody plays everybody. Like, just super high level, because I know we have a lot of new baseball fans. They probably have that similar question.
Yeah, so Lauren actually asked me kind of the same question along the same lines the other day. In you know, baseball is America's favorite pastime, obviously. And so there's a huge interest in it. There's lots of people who want to play it, and you have good competition all the way from D1 to D3. For example, Quinnipiac, their leadoff hitter yesterday, who I think was leading their team in average, you know, arguably their best player, last year was playing for a Division III school. And so he goes from, I think they said SUNY Cortland or Cortland State, I can't remember, goes from a Division III school, transfers to Quinnipiac, where he's now the leadoff hitter and center fielder. And so baseball is a huge, you know, it's a huge game, but the development and the outreach of the game, and especially the college game right now, is crazy because of the MLB lockout. And we've talked about that some in the Slack chat. You know, with the MLB lockout going on right now, everybody who's missed baseball, everybody who, you know, hasn't had anything since October with the World Series, it's starting to, you know, creep back in. Everybody's starting to get the itch. And now with ESPN having, you know, so many games on the ESPN Plus app and everything like that, people can get their fix, and it's just good. It's a good way to spend your Saturday afternoon, or, you know, like today, here, you know, it's pouring down rain. So they've got a doubleheader in yesterday, but, you know, it's a good way to just kind of kick back and relax when the weather's not good. You can watch baseball, or you can go to the game. But, the schools themselves, you know, a couple years back, you had Coastal Carolina winning the College World Series. You know, how many people not in Virginia, North Carolina, South Carolina, or Georgia had heard of Coastal Carolina before that? And they get to Omaha, you know, they got hot in the postseason, make it to Omaha, win the College World Series. I remember a couple years back, I think Stony Brook, you know, went on a crazy run. That you know, you have talent that can get together at these smaller schools, and baseball is very much a game of getting hot at the right time. Look at State last year. State got hot at the right time towards the end of the year and rolled into Omaha. And, you know, again, you guys know I'm still hot about it, but would have been the College World Series champion. Would have been. I mean, there's such a thing as momentum, and State had it all. And there was nothing stopping them last year except for the NCAA pulling that crap that they pulled. But, you know, it's growing. The game continues to grow. You have AAU. AAU teams, showcase teams, USSSA teams just popping up all over the place. And there's been a lot of buy-in, travel ball all over the place. I just don't want to see it go the way of basketball, you know, where AAU just kind of controls everything. And I don't think you will, just because of the process of how long it has taken AAU to come up, and the travel ball teams, Perfect Game, Impact Baseball, you know, all these different programs. And places that put together these showcase, these developmental type teams, and take them all over the country and play, and you get a lot more eyes on these players. And, you know, in baseball you only have 11.7 scholarships, so you got to divide that up amongst the team. A lot of guys are going to fall through the cracks. They end up going to D2, D3 schools, and you have talent up and down, even from the top echelon of D1 to the bottom echelon of D1, all the way down to D3. So Sorry, I know that was a long tangent to go on there, but I was just trying to describe, you know, everything for you.
No, it's good. Like, that's exactly what, like, that answers the question, right? ECU top 25 team just got swept by Bryant to open the season, right? These teams can play.
Oh, yeah.
And there's a lot of good baseball players out there.
Yeah, and I mean, you look at, like for example, Kobe Engel. You know, he pitched against Carolina last year, I think, in the tournament game, pitched well. In the game that didn't really mean much. I think it was in the ACC tournament. I'm not sure. And now, you know, he's at Western Carolina. So here's a guy who went in the ACC last year, you know, did pretty well, held his own against ACC competition. Now he's at Western Carolina. And so you have guys that transfer out because they want to – they maybe they're a relief pitcher, maybe they're a closer, and they want to become a starter, and that they want to pitch seven innings on a weekend instead of instead of two or three. And so they go to these smaller schools where now they're the big fish in a little pond, and they step in and they're, you know, they're showing off. And so you have that that trickle down effect all the way through the ranks. I can remember when I played in college, you know, there was a team that was in our conference. Every year they had a transfer from Tennessee or a transfer from UVA or somebody coming in, and you know they were good player, and I think they at sometimes you expect that drop off to be huge and significant, and like you're just going to come in and dominate, and people are actually really surprised to see that, you know, how well D3 ball is played. You know, for people listening, if you have a local D3, D2, JUCO team around you, go out and check them out. I mean, if you're a fan of baseball, you know, if you're making it to the college level, you can play. Obviously, the D1 guys, you know, they're the cream of the crop, but you're going to see good baseball throughout. And a lot of times, the difference between a D3 player and a D1 player is simply their size. There's a I won't say a mold, but there's an idea of what a perfect third baseman should look like, a perfect shortstop should look like. And a lot of times it's the size is the difference, that the reason why a lot of people choose to go or kind of forced to go the Division II, JUCO, Division III route, is because they don't fit the mold that certain college coaches look for. And so you kind of see that sometimes. I mean, the smallest player on the field oftentimes is the second baseman. And so, you know, you got to take that into account, that a lot of times if you're not 5'10", you know, or something like that, and you don't play second base, if you're not over 5'10" and not and playing and you are playing a position other than second base, you're probably not going D1. And I mean, that's just unfortunate, but that's just kind of the way of the world. And you know, scouts look at stuff like that and everything, but they'll find you even if you go D1, D2, D3. They'll find you, and the competition's always going to be good.
What do you, bringing it back to state? Mm-hmm. And I know we've had everything, you know, cupcakes and roses so far. What do you think about the pitching staff and the rotation? Are they strong enough to carry this team, or are they going to rely on the offense and then just have to be good enough?
Highfield is going to be good enough. You know, you're going to have some days where you just don't have your stuff, and you're hoping on those days, that's when the offense explodes to help you carry through anyway. Willitson, I think, you know, he's already proven he's good enough. He's gotten touched up a little bit, but last year he was great. And Harrison, you know, as far as the weekend rotation so far, he showed 2 years ago, you know, that he's got talent, and thus far he's looked pretty good too. I don't know, you know, Reed was kind of the anchor last year. I don't know if you're going to see Sam kind of just develop into that, even though Sam was arguably just as good as Reed, if not better last year. It's a tough question because we're only 2 weeks in. I do think that there are arms there. There's nothing overpowering, in my opinion. And, you know, like, I think Tennessee's got a guy like throwing 103 or something like that, you know, and you don't see, you're not seeing anybody top out that 100 mile an hour. You got Villeman but that obviously they've put him into the closer role. And I wouldn't be surprised to see if one of the starters do start struggling, I wouldn't be surprised to see Villeman move into one of their spots and then just kind of swap out and see how things go. But I overall do think that so far, if I had to grade it, I would say the offense is getting an A and pitching is getting a B+. So if you're looking at kind of carrying that over the season, I would say that right now we're more so hoping that the offense can carry the team, which they have been doing. And the pitching has not been bad by any means. You know, I made B's all my life. I'll take B's all day.
So, that's a great analogy. Yeah.
But go ahead.
No, I was just gonna say. So where do we go from here? Who do we have? I don't even know who we have this week.
To be honest, I have not looked between the new house, a baby, and everything else. I don't know. Let me pull up the schedule.
We got Campbell Wednesday. Ooh. And then a series with Northeastern this weekend.
Okay.
Campbell's pretty good.
Yes,
right?
That's always right around. I mean, just in the state of North Carolina, the teams that we play these midweek games, you know, Campbell, UNC Wilmington, ECU, Elon, they're always good games. UNC Greensboro. There's a lot of talented baseball programs right here in the state of North Carolina. And people, you know, it's a great opportunity to go out and watch. Campbell, I expect. I don't know much about Campbell. I've just been focused on NC State so far this year. But they're always a good game. They get up for it because it is NC State. I expect us to, on paper, we should win, but it's baseball. You never know. Next weekend, Northeastern, I believe, maybe 3 or 4 years ago, I believe Northeastern beat us. In the first round of the NCAA tournament, yeah. if I'm remembering correctly, it's just taking it game by game, week by week, or weekend by weekend. But looking at it from where I sit, I would expect us to be 12-0 next Sunday. You know, just based on looking at everything what we've put on the field so far.
Where do you think the ceiling is for this team? And I know, like, obviously Tommy White can't keep going at the pace he's going. Mm-hmm. And that's perfectly fine. Where do you think this team, way too early prediction, right? I mean, we're 2 weeks into the season. But where do you think this ends? Like, are they good enough to make the run to Omaha again?
I think, yes. I definitely think that. The offense has been very, very, very good. And obviously, Tommy White has been a huge part of that. But baseball is a lot of, like I said earlier, it's a lot about getting hot at the right time and carrying momentum. And, you know, that's not to say that State's not on the other side of that in a super regional this year, where maybe State's one of the top 8 seeds and hosting the super regional, and they run into a good team like State was last year, and the roles are reversed. You know, nobody in the world thought that State was going to take 2 of 3 from Arkansas. You know, and with Kevin Copps, no way. And you know, they did it. But I see, you know, Texas has got a heck of a team. The top 5, 6, 7 teams in baseball, it always seems to be the same that kind of rotate through. You got some, you know, the Big 12 teams, maybe 1 or 2 ACC teams, and then, of course, the SEC. But, you know, if you get hot at the right time, if you're good, you put a little luck to it and you get hot at the right time, anything can happen. But yes, I won't say if we don't make it to Omaha that it'll be a disappointment. But based on what I'm seeing, based on the talent that is there, we're a young team, lots of freshmen starting in very important positions, I will say. There's a reason. Look at the middle of the field. There's a reason that 80% of your scholarship money goes up the middle. And what I mean by that is 80% of your scholarship money goes toward 80% of the total scholarship money you have goes towards catchers, pitchers, shortstop, second baseman, and center field. And we have freshmen in 2 of those positions that, you know, behind the plate and at shortstop. And, you know, as a freshman catcher, Cozart, he's looked good. But a lot of times it takes some time to get some buy-in from the rest of your team. And that's your field general. I expect postseason.
Keep going, Zach. My headset just died.
Okay. I do expect postseason, and I do expect us to be hosting a regional. Would love for us to be hosting a super regional and and hopefully making it to Omaha. But, you know, it just kind of depends on the luck and how everything shakes out. And then, of course, injuries are always something to keep in mind, too. You know, if Sam goes down, then that drastically kind of alters the outlook of what we have and how we look going into the weekends. You know, where would we be right now without Tommy White? Who knows? You know, where would we be without X player or Y player? And it just, we do have a very deep bench, you know, and so it's all about just kind of how things shake out and the luck that goes involved and carrying on the hot streak and the momentum.
Thank you. My headset died. A more technical difficulty. Thank you.
We're powering through. I had to go on a little longer there.
I appreciate it. It's the sacrifices we make. Yeah, you know, and it's funny. You're bringing the conversation back to Tommy White. I think what's so impressive about him is not that he's just hitting bombs. Is that he's hitting the ball too. If it's not there, he's being productive. Like yesterday, bases loaded. Of course, he wanted to hit a home run. He was patient at the plate. He worked the count. Ended up hitting a line drive out the middle or over the shortstop's head. I forgot where it went, but it was clearly a good piece of hitting. And so he's not just all or nothing.
Right.
Right. We've seen that before from guys. And I keep coming back to MLB, an old MLB player, Adam Dunn, right? Led the league in strikeouts, led the league in home runs. That's not Tommy White. Tommy White has been productive even when he's not hitting it deep. I think that to me that is it's impressive, but it also shows that it's probably sustainable. Like he'll be able to keep hitting. He might not hit them all out of the park, but he'll be able to keep hitting because he's a good hitter.
Let me tell you real quick the best thing that he has going for him, and you've heard me hit on this in the Slack chat. So when a freshman comes in today's age, you know, they're able to go and look at their high school highlights, especially somebody that was highly regarded like Tommy White. But there's no scouting reports. Now, baseball teams have scouting reports, obviously, and even college teams have scouting reports where the coach will sit down with the pitcher and the catcher, and you work through the batter, the lineup, what you're looking to do, how you know what have we seen on tape that they struggle with, what have we heard, you know, stuff like that. Well, Tommy White came in, no scouting report really on him other than what you could pull out of high school and showcase and travel ball and all that stuff. So he comes in first weekend. It's great to see what he did. It was awesome. Well, then you've got three games, and in those three games, you're not really seeing a way to get him out. Then the two midweek games, okay, you're still getting tape, everything, you know, how we develop a scouting report on this guy. Well, the best thing that Tommy has going for him is that he is driving the ball to the middle of the field. Yes, he has 9 home runs. How many of those have just skirted inside the left field foul pole? None. You know, he's driving the ball to the middle of the field, and a lot of times – and again, you've heard me harp on this in the Slack chat over and over. When a guy is in a slump, it's because he's trying to pull everything. And the way you get out of a slump is you let the ball travel deeper to the zone. Like let the ball get closer to you. Keep your hands inside and try to drive the ball right back up the middle or right over the second baseman's head. And that improves your timing, helps keep your shoulder in, and it helps you stay over your base. And you look at like JT Jarrett, for example. He likes to cast his hands out. Well, yesterday he had literally a 90-foot gap. There's 90 feet between first base and second base. He had a 90-foot gap in between first base and second base because the first baseman was holding on a runner. Second base was behind second base, and he can't, you know, just let the ball travel and go that way with it. He's trying to pull everything. And with Tommy, when you got a guy who can take a fastball in on his hands and still get it over the center field fence, but can also wait on a breaking ball that's out over the plate and drive it over the right field fence, that's impressive. That shows an ability to hit to all fields. It's a tough out to get because, you know, in regards to pitching, it's all about messing up a hitter's timing and changing their eye level. You throw certain pitches to set people up. If you get an 0-2 count on somebody, a lot of times you'll see the pitcher come back with a high fastball. That's changing the batter's eye level and changing their timing. It's speeding them up. They're gearing up thinking, man, that was a high fastball. That was quick. I'm going to have to get my hands really quick. And then they come back with a slider or a curveball or a changeup low and away or something like that. And the batter's way out in front. their weight is not evenly distributed and they're way off balance. And even if they do get a bat on it, it's not hard. It's a routine pop-up, it's a ground ball, whatever. But Tommy has been very balanced at the plate. And I tell you, another person that you can watch this with is Devontae Brown. When you start seeing Devontae Brown pulling foul ball, foul ball, foul ball, he's not in his groove. Last night I was sitting there watching it with my dad, and he was kind of doing that. I said, he's pulling out. And then like two pitches later, he did like a check swing, or he took it. And I said, he kept the shoulder in on that one. Then he hit a double to the wall in right center. I said, that's all he's got to do. Just let the ball travel, keep your shoulder in, and keep your hands through it. You know, it's easy to sit here and talk about. It's tough to do when you got somebody throwing 90, 95 miles an hour up there. But that's the best thing that Tommy White has going for him is that his ability to drive the ball to all fields.
Yeah, I mean, you're right. And it's fun. To me, it's so fun to watch. And I think it gives me that excitement that he'll be able to continue to, you know, be productive.
Yeah.
And at one point he was on pace for 101 home runs. I'm like, it's insanity.
Yeah, right? And I saw this morning that said, I think that maybe the ACC or NCAA leader last year with RBIs, I think was 66. And maybe I'm wrong here, but he's already got 29 in 8 games. You know, it's a 56-game schedule. So, I mean, he's on track. Do I expect him to hit, what, you know, 92 home runs this year? Obviously not. But you know, kid's gifted. He's talented, and we have a lot of freshmen that are talented. Peyton Green has been impressive to me. Like I said, Cozart, Marcy, Will Marcy. There's been a lot of good young talent that has showed up on campus and looks to be doing really well. And not seeing anybody trying to do too much. You know, everybody's appears to just be staying within themselves, and that's, you know, he is a freshman. Tommy White is a freshman, so it would not surprise me to see him start trying to pull everything. He's got the home run bug right now, which is a good thing to have, but you kind of fall into that trap, you fall into that comfort, and you don't think, you're not going through the process as well anymore, and you start trying to pull everything. And so, you know, if you start to see that, he's getting into that slump. But then when he starts driving middle again, he'll his bat's waking back up and it's coming back around. And to give you an example of kind of what I'm talking about, remember last year with Luca Tresh, he started out hot. Where was he hitting the ball? I mean, he hit up 7 home runs in the first 7 games, I think. Where was he hitting them?
Yeah.
You know, he was not tucking them down the left field line. He's driving middle of the field. As the year went on, teams started to figure out if you throw Luca out over across the plate, outside corner, he's going to struggle. And if you especially if you can change speeds and locate out there. And he kind of tapered off as the year went on because he was not able to let the ball travel deep into the zone and drive it to the backside of the field. And if you can't do that at this level, you begin to struggle because teams figure that out. And especially as you move up and, you know, the upper echelon teams start to be able to, you have pitchers that can locate those secondary pitches, and you're going to continue to struggle. Now they'll miss occasionally over the plate, and you'll get one to be able to pull how you like to do it. But if you can't let the ball travel, keep your hands inside and use all fields, that makes it more difficult on yourself. You're catching everything off the end of the bat or you're swinging through it.
One of the guys who is also seeing the ball well, JT Jarrett, he's batting, before we recorded this, he was batting about 650. Mm-hmm. Like, he's off to a hot start too. Mm-hmm.
And so,
what do you think about JT Jarrett's play?
So JT, like I was kind of saying, I guess not all positive things about him earlier, but I mean, he's hitting the ball. And some people you find that, you know, that's just what works for them. And that's the way that they've done it, and that's the way they're going to continue to do it. I saw he had a bomb the other day, you know, and so it's always fun when JT Jarrett comes up there, and you know, he I think obviously he's the heart of the team just because of his status, how long he's been there. People look up to him, and he's just kind of cemented that position that he has there. But, you know, he's the one that I think everybody's going to look to. He's the one that when things get a little bumpy, him and Devontae Brown are the ones that people will kind of turn to him. You know, he'll keep everybody calm and everything. And speaking of Devontae Brown, did you read that piece that he wrote for D1 Baseball? About
awesome.
Yeah, that was I was really impressed with that. That was you know, like I said, I kind of wish he would have ripped into the NCAA a little bit more, but he's stronger than I am. I was really impressed.
Yeah,
with that.
So for those that don't know, Devontae Brown had a really well written piece on D1 Baseball, and it wasn't about necessarily what went down in Omaha or how it went down, but more the player side of it and what they heard, what they saw, and kind of their timeline, how they were feeling. I mean, it was really well done. It was really well articulated. And, you know, apparently he's been going to be writing for them for the rest of the season. So I'll be looking forward to that because I was impressed by that piece.
I was too, very much so.
Yeah. All right, Zach, any other baseball thoughts you got? I know I'm probably left something out. But
no, I know it's been tough for us to get up and got to have little short ones here and there with the baby and everything. Yeah. But I mean, so far, very impressed. I was yesterday when we got down in the first game of the doubleheader yesterday, I was kind of, you know, just waiting to see what happens, see how they would respond. And Quinnipiac definitely helped out with some errors, but State took advantage, you know, definitely took advantage of those things and capitalized on those. And that's what you want to see. That's what good teams do. Good teams make you really regret the mistakes that you make. And, you know, they did that and came back and won and State, you know, remain undefeated. And so I was impressed by the comeback. I was impressed that even after that, they came out in the second game and went right back to work. You know, so everything seems to be carrying over well from the end of last year. They've stayed hot, and hopefully it continues.
Yeah, hopefully it continues. It's fun to watch, and this momentum is really the start we all needed. How will they weather the ups and downs that are inevitably coming is going to be a big question. But right now, just enjoy it, man. This team is fun. Everything they have going for them and like just the attention they're getting, it's awesome.
Yeah.
And I think it's great for the program.
Yeah. And I agree. I mean, like I said at the beginning, the fan support there, and I know, you know, Chance goes to as many games as he can and texting a little bit back and forth with him. And, you know, he was just talking about how hype everything was and the turnout for everybody has been great.
Yeah. I mean, to show you that it's like, Our baseball channel in the pod chat has just been nonstop active. And that is just, that's such a new thing that's happening. It's everybody's engaging and having that conversation.
Yeah. And for the baseball lovers, that's great. You know, we love, you know, talking about it and just discussing it. And it's really good to see, you know, I mean, like Lauren, we're sitting here watching a game and she's asking me questions and things, you know, and I catch myself up. I'm like, she's not going to understand what that means because I played all my life and everything, and I use these words that nobody knows what they mean, you know, unless you've been in it. But it's really good to see and to see the I guess different levels of the crowd. The you know, you got little kids, you got the you know, older crowd that's always there. But you know, you just, it's a good range, I guess is the best way to say it. Of people there in the crowd cheering them on and everything. So that's good.
Well, Zach, I appreciate your time on Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
Go back and spend some time with your family, get your house unpacked, do all those things you need to do. But I can't wait to talk some more baseball as this season rolls on.
Yes, sir. And, you know, hopefully next weekend, maybe we can do it again after this week, maybe later on this week after a Campbell game or something. You know, we'll figure it out.
Yeah, sounds good. We've talked about, I'm not sure if Chance still wants to do it, but we have some other people that want to do some baseball Twitter Spaces Sunday night after the end of the series that we're playing on that weekend. We had a doubleheader last night, so I don't know if we probably should have done it yesterday, but I was talked out after all the basketball nonsense. So in the future, we'll probably do some of those Sundays as well, just to some easy, quick engagement. People have that conversation.
Yeah, so absolutely. Sounds
y'all
good.
Look forward to that.
Yes, sir. All right. All right.